This is the phone-in headquarters in London of the Social Democratic Party, the party that was launched this morning, the first major political birth in Britain since the Labour Party in 1900. In this room, volunteers have been anxiously waiting throughout the day for would-be members to pledge their allegiance and their money. Meanwhile, the Social Democrats' leaders have scattered to the four corners of Britain to spread the word. With them on their travels went TVI. This is the story of the SDP's first day. Coming up to 9 a.m. in rain-swept central London. Here at the Connaught Rooms in Great Queen Street, the Gang of Four gather with supporters from the House of Commons and the House of Lords for the press conference to launch Britain's new political party. At that press conference for TVI, Lou Gardner.
It began with a scrum down. Kodak and Ilford, at least, have caused to bless the new party. Anticipation mounted as we waited for the photographers to finish their business. Beyond all that Japanese technology, was there, perhaps, a new convert smiling modestly into countless lens? But when the clicking had to stop, it was the familiar faces of the Gang of Four who sat before us, neutrals as the party colours of red and blue suggested in the war between socialist and Tories. First, we were introduced to the lads on the substitutes bench, the 10 Labour MPs and the solitary Tory who have made the great leap into the political unknown. The formalities completed, Roy Jenkins, the prince who came back from over the water in Brussels, spoke the first words on behalf of the brand new party.
It becomes the Social Democratic Party. It is the biggest break in the pattern of British politics for at least 60 years, for two generations.
There had been talk of a detailed policy statement, but instead we got a 12-point list of tasks for Social Democrats. Less of a policy, more a quick tour of the peaks of a familiar land.
And I've always been struck whenever I've been in Britain by the extent to which we shackle ourselves, by the extent of our class system in Britain, and by the extent of the divisions that we live with in this country. For example, divisions...
There were no surprises. The Social Democrats are against pointless conflict, dogma and class hatred. With everything to gain by changing the voting system, they are very much in favour of proportional representation. Today they called for a consistent economic strategy, something described as a flexible incomes policy, and they pledged their support to a mixed economy.
Our country's in real trouble, and I think everybody knows it. They can see unemployment rising, and they can sense that we will not recover our economic strength.
Yet signs of delicate compromise were clear even in their short document. The state, we were told, should lean towards equality, but in the same breath, the Social Democrats warned that if the state leans too heavily, it could threaten individual liberty. Perhaps Mr. Brocklebank Fowler, conservative convert, had been making his presence felt. Real equality for women, a fair deal for all, whatever their colour, and a swift nod towards the environment, and the Social Democrats had said all they intended to say. It seems we will have to wait a little longer to know just how this better, more tolerant Britain is to be achieved. And for some of us at the press conference, there was one big nagging doubt. Lou Gardner, TVI. Although you have a new party, there's a number of quite familiar, if not old, political faces on the platform. All of you have been members of cabinets which have taken part in the decline of Britain, which you so much deplore. Why should people believe you will do better in the future than you did in the past?
The point about this new party, and yes, you've seen our faces before, the point about this new party is that it is a party which, for the first time in Britain, in the period since the war, is breaking with any of the major interest groups and trying to put the interests of the country first ahead of those other interests.
The end of the London press conference was the signal for phase two of the operation. The Gang of Four, or Four Principles, as their PR firm prefers to call them, split up to bring their message to the four corners of Britain. Shirley Williams, unshaken at being denounced as a Euro witch by the demonstrators, was headed for Heathrow Airport and a flight to Scotland. For Mrs. Williams, a moment of personal triumph. Defeat at the last general election, defeat within the Labour Party by the left, then the plotting and the planning. Now, for the moment, the arguments are over. The campaign to persuade the public to support her new party puts her once more in the limelight.
Social Democratic Party subscriptions.
As the leading characters in today's political extravaganza play out their parts, it's in hotel rooms like this around the country that the fruits of their labours are anxiously awaited. Here in London's St. Ermin's Hotel, volunteers are manning 20 special telephone lines over the next 4 days. And what they want to know is how well the promotional tours by the Social Democrats' leaders and the bright new SDP symbol are succeeding in attracting hard cash. Most of the £80,000 already raised will be used up in this one day, so what's wanted now are new members and new subscriptions. £9 per member would be ideal, they say, but they'd accept less from individuals, and more would be no bother at all. Would-be members need do no more in this 1980s-style recruitment drive than ring in, giving, if they wish, their credit card number. Unlike any other British political party, the SDP will instantly accept them as members and record their names on a central computer. Well, by late morning, already they've received around 100 phone calls, pledging on average slightly better than that £9 per head. A reasonable start for the Social Democrats, but obviously still a long way to go.
Dennis Healy. The Social Democrats seem to have plenty of leaders, but one wonders whether they have any organisation in the country. In your experience, can a party start from scratch like this without any grassroots organisation?
I don't really think it can. Mosley tried to do this exactly 50 years ago when he broke away from the Labour Party, and as you know, nothing came of it, so he formed the Fascist Party. And I think it's very, very difficult. It's very easy to appeal to the wonderful dream, a world in which there's peace, motherhood and all that. But when you start getting down to how you achieve it in practice, how you build up your strength from the grassroots, this, I think, is when the problems will appear.
It has been suggested that none of this would have happened, that the Gang of Four, as they're called, would not have gone their separate way, the new party would not have come into being, had you won the election for the leadership rather than Mr. Foote.
Well, I've heard that suggestion. I doubt whether that's entirely true. I think it is true, of course, that if the Wembley conference had gone differently, the split would not have taken place.
There are people who will ask, when will Dennis Healy join the Social Democrats? Can you put them out of their misery?
I think I can. Yes, I'm not going to join this new party. I believe that the Labour Party is the only base on which we can produce the sort of Britain I want, with the sort of people I like and want to work with.
Robert Carville gives his verdict on the Social Democrats' propaganda blitz.
Well, I think there's been more razzmatazz in this press conference than anyone I've ever been at in my life. And they're a slick, PR-orientated bunch who have had a very successful launch, in my opinion. Of course, at the moment, they've got a lot of generals, and what I want to know is where the troops are, and we're not going to know that for some time. They're going out into the grassroots now. It's going to take a long time for them to build up, probably much longer than they expect.
It has been said by their critics, including many in the Labour Party, that in general, and not just today, they are more of a media phenomenon than anything else. Do you think that criticism is justified?
They're very conscious of the use of the media to a political party. It's all they've got. If they haven't got grassroots yet, they've planted seed, they hope, but the grass hasn't come up. And so their easiest way to prominence and publicity is to make all the use they can of the media. And if I may say so, the media has certainly fallen for the trick.
How long do you think that media honeymoon will last, and how soon will it be before they start getting the kind of stick that is the common lot of politicians?
What they need is some early success. What they need is to win a by-election that really establishes themselves. But they made it pretty clear this morning that they're not going to risk their own heads, those MPs who are in the House now, to fight a by-election. They've got what they think is a good constitutional reason for not doing it. On the other hand, what they didn't mention was that one of the number, Dick Taverne, when he crossed the floor of the House, he resigned and fought his seat again and won the by-election. Perhaps they don't think they could do that, or they're not going to take a chance.
On the plane north to Edinburgh for a lunchtime press conference, Mrs. Williams spoke to Peter Gill.
Mrs. Williams, after all these months of doubts and preparations, how do you feel finally to be airborne as a party?
Oh, splendid. I mean, we're being airborne in all directions too, all parts of the United Kingdom. I thought this morning's press conference went well, but the ones that we rate as at least as important are the ones we're now doing in the different parts of Britain.
The doubts that you expressed about leaving the Labour Party, are they now very firmly behind you?
Certainly, absolutely.
What about your own personal position? If there is going to be one leader of the new party, are you going to be standing?
We've already said this morning that there was going to be a collective leadership of the party, until such time as we have sufficient members to decide. I think
would you stand
I
in
would,
those circumstances?
I'm not going to say what I might or might not do until that point has been reached.
What about getting back in the House of Commons? Are you going to be standing as a candidate in a very early by-election?
Well, I think we have to look at each by-election as it comes along, because obviously there are also discussions to be had with the Liberal Party about who stands for which by-elections and so forth. But I fully recognise that I may well fight a by-election before the next general election.
You want to get back in the Commons as soon as
yes.
possible?
Well, I wouldn't say as soon as possible, but I'd certainly like to get back pretty soon.
You're astoundingly popular in the polls at the moment, and you are only now beginning to define your policy positions. As you begin to define those, don't you think your popularity will decrease? In a sense, it's downhill from now on.
I'm bound to say that I think, on the contrary, that many of the policies that the public knows least about in respect of our position, namely economic policy, employment policy, industrial policy, are likely to be gains for the party and not losses. We have made no bones at all about issues that are unpopular. Equally, we shall make very clear issues on which I suspect we will be popular.
It's 1 o'clock and this is Peter Grant with the Radio Oxford News. The Social Democratic Party, Britain's new political party, with the
At Nuffield College, the prospects for the newborn party in the light of their current high standing in the opinion polls are examined by political analyst David Butler.
If you took the latest polls as an exact indication of how the votes would go, the Social Democrats and Liberals would get 500 seats between them. The other parties would be nowhere. It would be the greatest landslide since 1931. It is, you know, it's unthinkable, a total revolution in British politics.
What is the point that they need to get to in percentage support in order to make the major breakthrough in parliamentary seats?
They need rather more than the Conservative or Labour parties because their vote is so evenly spread. They need to get, I think, 35-36% of the vote in order to start being in, with a chance of getting a clear majority. And they need to get over 20% of the vote to start getting the significant number of seats which would give them a leverage, a stranglehold, a balance of power position in British politics.
What kind of seats are they likely to win on present reckoning?
I think that they will do best in southern, urban, marginal sorts of seats. But there are wild thoughts, you know. If Lloyd Jenkins were to challenge Mrs. Thatcher in strong suburban Finchley, might he win? If Shirley Williams were to challenge Tony Benn in a newly redistributed seat in Bristol, would she win? You might get some of these flamboyant challenges and you might get the most unexpected results. If the Social Democrats are getting, and Liberals as an alliance, are getting in 30-35% of the vote, you're going to get some very surprising results and some very surprising casualties.
How crucial is it to their prospects that there should be some kind of alliance with the Liberals?
I think it's almost essential. The Liberals do have a nationwide local organisation. They do have a lot of support. There are 15% or so of people who are almost certainly will vote Liberal at the next election. And if the Liberals and the Social Democrats started quarrelling with each other, this would be disastrous for them.
We believe, and we attach great importance to this, that we can reconcile rather than tearing apart the nation and give Britain as a whole a renewed purpose and success in the future. I'm open to your questions.
Brian Gould for TVI Thames Television. Mr. Jenkins, you've been out of British politics for 4 years and you've spent that time working for the common market, which is hardly the most popular institution in Britain today. Doesn't that mean that you're out of touch? And won't your common market connection make it difficult for you to be accepted back into British politics?
I don't know, that's for the British people to decide. I have not found, since returning, a great antipathy to the policies we've been expounding, or to the fact that I have been away doing an important job for the past 4 years. I've not found personal hostility. I've found a lot of people come and listen to me speaking, whether they agree or not. As a matter of fact, they mostly do seem to agree at the present time. But we'll see for the future. But at any rate, I do not think that having done a public service job outside Britain for 4 years, ought in the integrated world in which we inevitably live at the present time, to disqualify one from playing a part in British politics in the future, as I have done in the past.
Lunchtime in Edinburgh, and Mrs. Williams arrives for her next press engagement. Scottish journalists want to know about Social Democrat support north of the border.
It's sometimes alleged that we haven't got any support north of the border. That isn't true. And indeed, it's very marked that the amount of support in Scotland has increased. And I suspect it will increase even more following the Scottish, the conference of the Labour Party in Scotland recently.
Clearly, the next issue is devolution. Today. Mrs. Williams is in favour, but she's reminded that some prominent Scots in the new party are opposed to it.
Martin Donald, the Scotsman. Doesn't this really, this contradiction, prove that, as Peter Walker says, you're just a depot for deserters?
Well, I think that would be, if I may say so, seems to be about the level of comment that the opposition parties have made so far. I'm not over-impressed by them, and I'm not going to go in for throwing that kind of stupid stuff around myself, because I don't think it's what the British electorate or the Scottish electorate wants.
This is LBC News Radio.
It's 3 o'clock. This is Alan Clark. Liberal leader David Steele has given the Social Democrats just 3 months to make a deal with the Liberals. Mr. Steele says there must be an agreement...
Lord Thornycroft, how seriously do you now take the Social Democrats?
I think what is happening is a serious and important thing. But by far the most important part of it is that we're witnessing the disintegration of the Labour Party as we knew it.
But is all the disadvantage to the Labour Party? Because the polls show, in fact, that the Social Democrats have an appeal across all classes and across the political spectrum. They pose a threat, surely, to you in a different way, in an electoral way, just as much as they do to the Labour Party, do they not?
But I was dealing with existing facts.
I take that
point. What you're speaking about now is speculation as to the future of the Social Democrats. I think you must remember there that they are socialists. They say so. They would not deny the fact that they stand for the left of the centre. And they will go for a wealth tax. They go for an incomes and prices policy. They, in fact, go for most of the policies that have been tried and failed. They stand upon the manifesto that the Labour Party fought on at the last election. If they produce new wine, it's in very old bottles indeed.
But there are, of course, Conservatives who are attracted to them. Brocklebank Fowler, for instance, is not a socialist. Are you not afraid that you will lose some of your voters, some of your supporters, and perhaps some of your MPs to them?
Well, they, like any Liberal today, would find it very difficult, if he's in his right mind, to leave the Liberal Party or the Conservative Party and fight upon the very manifesto that he attacked at the last election. I don't see it happening on a large scale by responsible and serious people.
Perhaps surprisingly, on their launch day, the Social Democrats are holding only one public meeting, and that's here in Taunton in Somerset. The man who organised that meeting is Councillor Trevor Smith, a former Labour councillor. Councillor Smith, do you really expect to get much support for the Social Democrats in this strongly Conservative area?
Well, as you can see, people are going in their hundreds to our meeting tonight. Certainly, the area has been traditionally Conservative over the years, but many people feel that the Conservative Party has failed them. Their traditional support has always come from places like Taunton and Somerset, and I think that we see ourselves as being a major political force in the West Country in the future.
Why have you come to the meeting tonight?
To come to listen to David Owen and make up my mind whether I'll join the SDP.
Do you welcome the new party?
I do indeed. I've been waiting for this moment for several years. We badly need a realignment.
Well, Mr. Chairman, fellow Social Democrats, when I look at this audience and I see this packed hall, and some of you, I fear, with no seats outside, I begin to sense the power and the force of the principles and the beliefs in social democracy that I believe are going to sweep this country. But I don't think any of us thought that here in the constituency of the chairman of the 19... Tories must be wondering whether there's anything safe left now. And as for the Labour Party, I really do think Michael Foot better leave Ebervale occasionally and come back to the West Country.
How many seats do you think a Social Democratic Party might win at the next election?
I wouldn't speculate.
I think it depends entirely on whether the Labour Party can reverse the drift towards an unrepresentative extreme position, which I think many people feel has taken place over the last 2 years. It also depends, of course, on whether they
can make an effective alliance with the Liberal Party, and that is still a very long way off.
I think the Social Democrats might take about 15, and I think with an alliance the Liberals might take as many as 30 or 40.
It depends on what sort of battle, whether they can get the Liberals to stand down. I very much doubt whether they will in the country.
Well, tonight at phone-in centres like this, they're beginning to find out how well they'll do in the country. Over 700 have joined at this one centre in the course of the day, about 100 in the last half hour alone. The pace seems to be hotting up. From TVI at the end of the SDP's first day, good night.